There's more coverage in the newspapers today about the New Year's Eve fireworks in London than there is about long COVID. And I was looking at the story. I was trying to work out why some people were getting their knickers in such a knot about it. Nothing's been cancelled, you know. You can't cancel something that was never scheduled. As far as I can tell, it was going to cost sort of £3 or 4 million plus policing. And you have to start arranging it quite early on. And they didn't. We only came out of lockdown in July. You know, the guarantee that we wouldn't be in some sort of lockdown on New Year's Eve is still not in place, especially given the conversation we had in the last hour. So if you'd outlaid and spent a couple, could you imagine the coating the mayor would get if he'd spent £2 million on something that then got cancelled? Oh, how could he have done that? Did he not know about coronavirus? Did he not? But it was never in the diary. I've tried to establish this. You can't cancel something that's never been scheduled, can you? I don't think you can. But anyway, more in the... It's only a couple of paragraphs, or one paragraph here and there. But still, remarkable, really, as the most prestigious school in the country is sticking kids in lockdown, and newspapers are telling you more about a firework display that never was. It's a bit like the National Trust story. Do you remember that? About audience participation? Well, they're not going to be singing Jerusalem the last night of the proms, not the National Trust. And you sort of, we all get caught up in it. I'm not having a swing. You think, well, that's a bit, why aren't they doing that? That's outrageous. And then someone just says in your ear, Mr. Calm from Calmland, just says, there's no audience this year, mate. They can't have an audience sing-along if there's no audience. And then normal people go, oh, yeah, all right, I'll relax then. 52% of the country just pretend they haven't heard, or they pretend it's not right. That's outrageous. How can you not be singing Land of Hope and Glory at the last night of the proms? You say, there's no audience there, mate. Oh, shut up. How can the audience not be singing Land of Hope and Glory at the last night of the proms? It's the same sort of thing, I think. This is just, I can't believe they've cancelled the firework display. They haven't. It was never going to be on. The combination of costs and coronavirus and uncertainty just meant it was a sort of decision that seems fairly, I don't know. I'll ask Sadiq Khan next time he's in. In fact, you can ask him. You can put a rocket up his proverbial, metaphorically, if you wish. But I can't quite see, unless I'm missing something quite significant, I can't quite see how you can cancel something that was never scheduled in the first place. Speaking of things that happen in the British media that confuse me, sometimes I say things to you, and almost before I've reached the end of the sentence, I find myself thinking, oh, wind your neck in, mate. Honestly, you're going to have to start swimming with the tide a little bit. You're going to have to go with the flow sometimes. Why do you always have to be the bloke with his arms folded at the Nuremberg rally? Why can't you just stick your arm in the air like everybody else does? And I found myself thinking, last week I think I said to you, if they can turn you against doctors, and they can turn you against firefighters, and they can turn you against teachers, then they can turn you against anyone. And I thought, what are you doing? Are you auditioning to be a slogan on a tea towel? Or are you actually making a serious political point? And I thought for a while that I might have fallen into a sort of slightly lazy sloganeering state of mind when I shared that thought with you. I tweeted it as well. If they can turn you against teachers, doctors and firefighters, they can turn you against anyone. But sometimes the only person you can answer to is yourself. The only conscience that you possess is your own. And the only moral compass you can plot your course through life with is the moral compass in your own pocket. And I'm sorry, but I really think this is true, and I think the media has proved it this week. Sajid Javid now seems to me to be embarked upon a deliberate campaign to turn patients against doctors. I would love you, at risk of sounding even more like Kevin Keegan talking about Manchester United than usual, but I would love it, I'd love it if you could persuade me that I'm wrong. But I can't see any other analysis. Even on Sky News, he got asked the other day whether who was running the health service, him or the Daily Mail. And this idea, I mean, there's so much wrong with what's going on at the moment. I actually don't know where to start. You have a health service, a GP, what's the line? Is it front line? No, first port of call? I forget precisely what it is, but it doesn't matter. The GP surgery, the numbers of GPs have been decimated in the last 11 years. We have a shortage of GPs. We chased another bunch out of the country as a consequence of Brexit. As with every other shortage, it was probably there already, and we just made it worse because we wanted to take back control. So there's a shortage of GPs. And in order to cut their cloth accordingly, they have been seeing more people online or on the phone than they have been face to face, because there are more patients than they can see. So they have almost by necessity brought in tactics that allow them to conduct more consultations person to person than they could do if they were conducting consultations face to face. Person to person, face to face, or no consultation at all. Take your pick. Oh, I'd like face to face, James. All right, that means they get no consultation at all. All right, I'll have, so two people person to person, or one person face to face and one person no consultation at all. Obviously, it would happen eventually, but I'm talking about right now. I've got 40 minutes. I can do 20 minutes on the phone, or I can do one face to face. I don't get it. Sajid Javid is an odd politician because he did something that nobody else has done post-Brexit, and that is, I suppose Amber Rudd sort of did. All right, he's done nothing. He did something that nobody has done since Boris Johnson became Prime Minister, in that he displayed personal principle when he resigned as Chancellor of the Exchequer. I may be slightly misremembering, or I may be so desperate for some sort of scintilla of positivity to be applied to any members of the current government that I am being a little bit too kind to him, like I was to blooming Matt Hancock for most of the last year. And look where that got me. But I think his refusal to go along with Dominic Cummings's power grab of civil servants was both admirable and right. It was very simply, if I understood the story correctly, the case that Sajid Javid refused to, I wish I could use a rude word that describes a female dog, but I can't. He refused to be Dominic Cummings's puppet. There you go. You can all work out what word I wish I could use. I listen to too much hip hop. So Sajid Javid refused to be Dominic Cummings's puppet. And then, you remember, Barnard Castle came along and you saw just how much of your soul you had to have sold in order to go along with the idea that Dominic Cummings was some sort of genius. So Javid did that. And I don't want you to tell me anything that makes me not admire him for doing that, because you have to have some reserves of admiration for the people in charge. Otherwise, the vista, maybe you don't actually, but for me at least, it's just all too bleak to bear if you can't occasionally say, well, they seem all right. And I know that you're thinking, well, look where that got you with Matt Hancock. A little bit of Rishi Sunak as well, I think, last year. But I don't want to think they're all awful, because I'm a human being and I live here, you know. So I liked the fact that Sajid Javid demonstrated what appeared to me to be principle and or integrity. But I don't know what he's playing at now. I really don't know what he's playing at. And I think today, if you don't mind, I'm not going to put doctors to the front of the queue, because we are all patients, all of us. And I've got that perpetual problem now of not really, I think because probably because I've been proved so catastrophically right about Brexit, people who disagree with me tend not to ring me up as much as they used to do. And that's absolutely fine. But it means that I always have to speculate about what goes on in the minds of people who I think are wrong. So I would love you to tell me, for example, why you've got a problem with doctors. And I don't mean your medical history. I mean somebody in politics and media, the Daily Mail and the Secretary of State for Health, are kind of encouraging you to hate on GPs, right? Now, until I started doing this for a living, I'd have giggled at this point at the absurdity of that being possible. But shortly after I started doing this for a living, and I've told you this a bazillion times, there was some industrial action undertaken by firefighters and the scales fell from my eyes. I was in newspapers, I was a showbiz journalist and a gossip columnist. I never did the grown-up stuff. I didn't realise what went on in the right-wing tabloids. I didn't make my bed according to what the Sun or the Mail was saying. My dad worked for the Telegraph, but that was in the days when the Telegraph was a profoundly respectable newspaper rather than a sort of Paul Dacre tribute act like it is now. I just didn't know. I was naive, I was innocent, and I was ignorant. Then this firefighter dispute happened. People whose houses I'd been to for dinner were coming out attacking firefighters in their columns. People who I thought were good friends of mine were appearing on television saying, oh yeah, they've all got flats in Ibiza. You can't trust a firefighter. And I genuinely had an existential crisis. I thought, what the hell is happening? This is just nuts about my profession. I was a son of a newspaper man. All I ever wanted to be was a journalist. And then I saw, like, I mean, it was like the clouds parted. And I saw what happens. I saw that tabloid journalism is just dedicated to encouraging people to act against their own interests and in the interests of their owners. And it's not even that cynical. It's just puts more bums on seats. And I coined this phrase, which runs through my life now like Blackpool through a stick of rock. It is easier to sell tickets for the ghost train than it is for the Speak Your Wake machine. I'll tell you something that's not true, that's not healthy, that's not fair, and's not decent, but gets you really riled and gets you absolutely furious. I'll be cashing my checks till the sun don't shine. I'll tell you something that's true, or fair, or decent, but doesn't paint a target that you can start throwing things at. I'll be handing my sandwiches wrapped in a roadmap and my P45 by tea time. Although we're doing okay. So, when I say to you now, if they can turn you against doctors, they can turn you against anyone. I'm not thinking, oh, crikey, is that a little bit too much? I'm thinking it's too late, mate. They've already done it. How does that work? How does that work? 0345 60 60 973. It's a bit of envy involved. Oh, they earn so much money. They earn a hell of a lot less than they used to do. Oh, they've got such an easy life. They don't. How does it work? I can understand you've been successfully turned against, you know, Premiership footballers who treat women appallingly and get paid $10 billion a day, right? That's easy. How? I don't know if I will ever understand how you can be turned against firefighters, teachers, doctors. And if you're a forelock tugger, you've been turned against members of the royal family. They were supposed to be sacred. They were supposed to be the one section of our society that you'd never be turned against. And then one of them married a woman of colour, and lo and behold, he's public enemy number one as well. It's incredible, right? And there aren't that many days when it gets to me, because I'm used to it now. It washes over me like so much sea. But when it's doctors in the firing line, for flip's sake, what have we become? Doctors! Where are you going to go if your kid's got long COVID, which is becoming more likely by the day as a consequence of government policy? Where are you going to go? Quick Fit? Or are you going to go to the doctors? Where are you going to go? The Daily Mail's office in Kensington? Ask them for help with your sick kid? Or are you going to go to the doctors? Going to ask me, some gob on the stick on the radio, thumping his desk and banging on about how they should do more work? You going to ask me to look after your sick kid? Or are you going to ask a doctor? I don't understand how it works. And I doubt you can tell me, but you can tell me this. What do you think Sajid Javid is playing at with this idea of a league table which will name and, quote, shame, end quote, you if your surgery doesn't do more face-to-face appointments, which I presume means fewer appointments overall. So we have now reached a point in the cycle of government where the Secretary of State for Health is going to name and shame GP surgeries unless they cut the number of consultations with patients that they do at a time of crisis and shortage, because the tension between face-to-face and person-to-person has been completely weaponized by some of the most irresponsible journalism I have ever seen in my life. You know what I say at this point. Please tell me I'm wrong. 0345 60 60 973. And if you can't tell me I'm wrong, tell me what you think Sajid Javid is playing at. As a doctor, as a patient, as a punter, as a person. How can it be a measure of success for a surgery to cut the number of patients that a doctor is talking to? And how the hell can we be going along with it and buying newspapers that think that this is a positive outcome? I don't know. I really don't know. And I'm not sure I ever will. Of course, the other point to make is that we've gone in the space of 12 months from clapping them all on Thursday nights to thinking that they all need to be clapped in irons and stuck on lists of shame. And that's all down to the new Secretary of State for Health, Sajid Javid. Oh, boy. I was very fond of that alliteration. You know my fondness for alliteration. Punter, person, patient. But actually, the first caller on the line is a doctor. Mark's in Macclesfield. Mark, what a waste of a brilliant... I should have said general practitioner, punter, patient, person. But you're a hospital doctor, I think. What would you like to say?
Hi, James. All right. I really resent having to kind of ring in, because I find it kind of crazy that we all of a sudden find ourselves in a situation where we're having to defend GPs the way we are.
Tell me about it.
Unlike me,
you've got better things to do.
I just kind of felt compelled to ring in. Like I said, I'm not a GP myself, but my wife's a GP, and I know plenty of GPs. and they kind of share the same ethos that I have, which is, you know, they're hardworking people, they're extremely professional, they genuinely care about people, and they go above and beyond the call of duty to provide for them. And, you know, my wife, you know, she, technically her hours of work are like, you know, 8 till 5 or whatever, but frequently, you know, she leaves at 6:30 and she comes back after 11 at night because, you know, this idea that GPs aren't seeing people.
But if she does that 3 days a week, she's part-time in the language of the Daily Mail.
Yeah, of course. I mean, the thing is, you know, this idea that she's not seeing patients is first of all, ridiculous. Yes, there is a kind of a triage process that basically works both for patients and the surgery, in that, you know, all you ever hear about these days with the NHS is efficiency savings, efficiency, efficiency. And yeah, it makes the GP practice work more efficiently. You know, some of the backlogs that have acquired in cancer services, etc. You know, all the blame's being put on GPs. But you've got to remember that people weren't presenting to the GP practice for months on end, and that was from government, you know, government advice really, and that kind of the fear that was out there, rightfully so, certainly at the start, about, you know, presenting to hospital, presenting to GP. The hospitals were empty at the start. Well, outside of COVID, of course.
Sure.
And so it's just incredibly frustrating that all of a sudden, this obviously at a time when the government's coming under pressure on many other faces, that all of a sudden GPs are in the headlines for all the wrong reasons without really any
Baffled. I mean, I can understand you're upset, but you're also completely baffled, right?
I am.
Yeah,
I really am.
I can hear it in your voice.
The thing is, what I actually know to be true, certainly at my wife's practice and others, is GPs are seeing are going through far more appointments than they've ever done.
Yeah,
you know, the quantity of work they're doing is absolutely staggering. It's unsustainable, in fact, is what I would probably call it.
Yeah,
but it's being managed because that's what the service is.
And you know, they're getting a kicking from their nominal bosses, really, when it comes to Sajid Javid. You know, the ultimate boss, well, making them all feel worthless.
This is so cyclical, and like you sure. pointed out, you know, whether it's teachers or doctors, whoever it is,
firefighters.
You know, someone comes into a new position. They want to make big statements that are headline grabbing and, you know, grab the public's attention and draw attention away from the real problems that are actually going on right now, which, you know, many of them are government generated. So I resent having to ring up. I resent having to defend a group of people that I know work incredibly hard, not just doctors, but also everyone in GP practices.
Yes, it is, and I'll use the word again, it is baffling until you remember how the model of right-wing media and scapegoating and distraction from the people who are actually in charge works. How hurtful is it, and you can do this because you've got that distance, it's your wife rather than you. How much of the rhetoric reaches the patients, do you think?
Listen, a lot.
Right.
You know,
that's the bit that really boils my.
I know for a fact that the levels of abuse that they're getting at practices these days is far higher than it's probably ever been. I know that lots of reception staff, for instance, I've heard of several practices where reception staff are quitting because they are on the coalface and they're, you know, the first people to get a mouthful. You know, by generating this rhetoric, you increase this sense of kind of entitlement and of unrealistic expectations. You know, ultimately, the NHS is a service that is funded by the government and has restrictions. You know, for instance, let's take people. You've still got some GPs who do work from home, but do you know why? Because they've been put in a risk group. You know, within HR, which is basically dictated by NHS England, that says, you know, they're not safe to come into a red zone or, you know, into a hospital practice. So, you know, you can't set the rules and then.
Well, you can. This lot can.
Well, I know that's what happens, but.
Go and sit in the corner over there. I can't believe you're sitting in a corner over there. Let's get the Daily Mail on the phone and attack all people sitting in corners without mentioning that we ordered them to sit in corners.
It's absolutely Staggering. Yeah. It's not staggering because I expect it, but
still
it
staggers
me. Extremely infuriating.
And it makes everything worse, you know? That's the most amazing thing about this, is it makes everything worse. Morale is lower, performance inevitably gets affected. And then to make it even madder, you've got Jeremy Hunt, the last health secretary, but two or three, coming out and sounding more like me than Sajid Javid, and more like you when it comes to the absurdity of trying to prioritise face-to-face appointments, which will, right? I mean, just correct me if I'm wrong, Mark. You prioritise face-to-face appointments, you reduce overall number of appointments.
Precisely. Yeah. Listen, when I talked earlier about, you know, GPs are trying to be efficient because the demand is so enormous. It's enormous.
Of course, it is.
And why is it enormous? Because people are scared, people have had a tough time of late. Some people haven't presented and are presenting late with physical symptoms. Lots of people have mental symptoms. And guess what? There aren't that many GPs around.
No, and they're more likely to leave. I know the BMA have warned that some of this stuff will prompt people to retire early, to redraw their working life. Mark, thank you. I'm going to move on because I did say that this would be one of those NHS phone-ins where we talked to patients more than we usually do. We're normally very blessed on this programme in that doctors queue up to talk to us. Other programmes, of course, have to book them. I'll give you an example. Prakash has tweeted me to say, on Tuesday, I did 73 emergency telephone appointments over 10 hours. If these were 10-minute face-to-face appointments, I'd have to be consulting non-stop for 13 hours, which just isn't safe, James, or practical or possible. So fewer people would be sorted. And a BBC radio station is obviously following my Twitter and has asked Prakash to get in touch with them. On this programme, thankfully, we don't need to do that because people like Mark will ring me. But I do want patients to feel welcome today as well. And I do want to know what you think Sajid Javid is playing at. 0345 6060973. With love and respect, I don't want to know your medical history or how rude the receptionist is at your GP. We're talking about the entire country and the alacrity and the speed with which you have taken up an invitation to hate on doctors. I suppose if there's a silver lining, at least it's given firefighters and teachers a day off. Adam's in Bradford. Adam, what would you like to say?
Adam, firstly, I'd just like to say thank you for being the voice of sanity and reason throughout the last few years that I've been following it. One thing I'd like to say is, you know, the root cause of the problem, it's not actually about the sudden upsurge. There have been problems in the system for a long time. This was based on the reorganisation of the NHS. If you take a bunch of GPs, general practitioners, qualified and experts in their field, and put them into management roles at CCGs, PCNs and clusters up and down the country, the impact is those GPs are no longer able to see and assist their patients. GPs want to get back into practice. We've thrust management as part of this stupid reorganisation down their throats. And now, you know, they simply can't see patients. In your typical GP surgery up and down the country, there will be one day lost to CCG or PCN or cluster-type management work.
And who would have done that previously?
That would have been done by actual business managers that worked as part of the primary care trusts, as the PCTs.
And what was the rationale behind changing that?
I don't want to get sort of politics into it, but the Tories at the time thought it was a fantastic idea to let the GPs run these type of
services. Just to decentralise and to have, in the same way that it's just like the GP's version of academy schools. I know I sometimes come across like a know-it-all, Adam, but I'm really not. I need help sometimes.
It was absolutely stupid. I was at the forefront. I've worked in general practice for a decade. So you had GPs expected to take over the roles of senior managers.
So they could cut down on centralised local government type roles or local council type roles.
I'm
late for the news. I just want to ask what you think about the league tables as well.
Well, I think it's disgusting. It just is.
I mean, could you imagine? We've got people in the cabinet who don't know what the customs union is and they're introducing league tables to assess GPs.
Absolutely disgusting.
Adam, thank you. We'll talk again, I sense. And it is a question for the ages. Why do vested interests seek to turn us against doctors? And why do so many of us take up the invitation? No institution is perfect, but if you cut it and if you discourage people from joining it and if you encourage people to leave it, then political leadership is responsible for many of the problems in that institution, not the people left in it. Sajid Javid apparently completely fails to understand this. And I'm speaking to Mark, the hospital doctor whose wife is a GP, about how much of the rhetoric reaches to the patient. It's always going to be anecdotal, but it's heartbreaking. And you know, you only need to take a quick look at something like the LBC Facebook page to see how comfortable people are these days being massively vile and disgusting in public, some of them even using real names rather than just sort of fake names and avatars of dogs. They don't usually sign the actual real mail, these people. I still get a couple, you know. I keep thinking I'd like to read them out on the radio, but they're absolutely illiterate, usually. And oddly, the handwriting on this one looks rather like the handwriting on one of my more regular correspondents in the old hate mail box. And I'm going to read it to you, but Keith, you're going to have to keep your finger above the bleep button quite. So this has been sent to a GP surgery in Salford and Trafford, just near Manchester. I don't remember what LMC stands for, forgive me, but Salford and Trafford LMC, dedicated to supporting general practice in Salford and Trafford survive and thrive. And they write this: would doctors from other sectors receive such venom from patients? Do consultants get abused for delivering virtual outpatient clinics? The government is blind to the magnitude of its failings across all health and social care sectors, and GPs are taking the blame again. And this has been left in one of the surgeries that they represent. Okay, I'll read it to you, but Keith's doing the heavy lifting for the next 60 seconds or so. Get Dr. Death. People are suffering because of your cowardly behaviour. Everyone else is back working in NHS apart from you, special people. Your now 100 grand a year receptionist, Harold Shipman, was more conscientious than you, shower of... I've sat COVID out and common cold bug twice while you were sat drinking coffee. You should be ashamed of yourselves. Not one bit of compassion in your bones. Imagine dragging yourself to work, knackered as a doctor, and finding that on your doormat. Well done, everybody. Michael's in Worcester. Michael, what would you like to say?
Hello, James. Hello. Thank you for having me.
You're very welcome.
I was listening to you and it sort of got me riled up a little bit.
Go on.
And in a way that I'm like, I hear you, but my view's been tarnished from experience, not from the media or government. And I think government's problem is they are just so out of touch. And somebody needs to do a bring government to work day or something.
Yes.
Just so that, you know.
Well, tell me what your experience was that's tarnished your view of GPs. I warn you in advance, I might be tempted to try and persuade you that actually that's the fault of politicians, but I know nothing of what you're going to tell me. So I just want to warn you in advance in case you're not expecting it.
No, that's fine. You do you. But, we had a little girl during the pandemic and the hospital, given the situation, were amazing, and I can't fault them. They let me in when I was allowed to be in. They let me stay longer than I should have before they kicked me out. And then they let me come back the next day for an hour, just so I could be there. And that was, given the situation, no criticism. But then, since then, I've seen a health visitor twice.
Yes.
And you sort of think to yourself, well, have people forgotten that we've lost people, but people are also coming into the world? And you've got a pandemic. You're not allowed, you know, we weren't allowed to have a support bubble until Christmas. So we had nearly 5 months of just figuring it out. And we sort of got into the mindset of, well, they were fine in the Victorian times, so well managed.
I don't want to use the word grievance because that's been slightly weaponized lately, but you feel a bit abandoned.
Yeah, I suppose abandoned would be the right word, because when you phone them, they don't have the answer. They say, talk to the GP. Well, you phone the GP and they don't have it. And it's just been funny hopping around. I wouldn't say we've been a burden. We haven't been that type of couple that's phoning every 10 minutes.
You know, no, but is it your first baby?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, mate, tell me about it. I mean, mine had a runny eye. I thought she had conjunctivitis and took it to A&E. I mean, we've all, with the first baby, we're a little bit more concerned or conscientious than we are with others. So I know exactly what you speak of, but I don't know, and I did warn you I was going to do this, I don't know why that would inform negative feelings towards the NHS, because just, I mean, cursory.
It's not towards the NHS.
Who's it to then? Who's it to?
It's just towards the few individuals that we could have used, you know, we could have needed a couple of times.
But I mean, I'll tell you now, just for context, between 2015 and 2019, the health visitors, I mean, about one in five health visitors were lost. The workforce went down by an 18%. There was a report in October of last year about health visitors having 2,400 families with newborns on their books at a time. That's 10 times the recommended number. That's not their fault.
No, and to be fair, I haven't looked into facts and figures and stuff.
That's right. That's why you phoned the James O'Brien show. So you've highlighted beautifully how easy it would be for me to take your feelings, which are based on your facts, what has happened to you, and someone less intelligent than you could be turned into someone who rails against the health visitors and the doctors. They could be sending letters like the one I read out before you came on, when the reality is that you've had 11 years of political leadership that has seen in the 2015 to 2019, so I don't even know what it is if you bring it up to 2021, but I doubt it's better. Cuts. Called it austerity. Yeah. And then you have some health visitors with 10 times the recommended number of cases. I find those people who don't get to see their health visitor. And if I'm a politician that's responsible for this situation, if I can make you cross with the health visitors, Michael, then I am golden.
Yeah, I agree. I'm not cross. I just wanted a little bit of faith.
Yeah.
You know, just a couple of times. And like, I've got a friend whose little girl had conjunctivitis.
Yeah.
And
are you sure it wasn't just a runny eye?
Well, eventually mum took her to hospital after 2 weeks of phoning the doctors and being told, don't worry about it.
Yeah.
And it just makes you lose a little bit of faith.
It does. It does. But there won't be a doctor in the land that wouldn't want to do more.
On the pillar.
Yeah. And that's the challenge. That's the challenge the country faces, is to resist the urge to blame the understaffed, underfunded, under-resourced, undervalued professionals on the front line, and to resist temptations or put in front of us to find one bad apple and therefore set fire to the whole barrel, and focus instead upon making things better and picking on the right people. But I'm glad you rang in. I needed that little kind of balance to the programme, because nothing you said was either untrue or unfair. But the causes of what has happened to you is unfair, are a lot closer to the Secretary of State for Health, or the last few Secretary of States for Health, than they are to the people in Worcester currently plying their trade as health visitors. And it's important to remember that. And it's important to remember that when you've got a baby and you want to see a health visitor, you don't really care about the statistics or what the ONS has to say. You just want to see a health visitor. And that appetite, that desire, can be moulded by carefully written newspaper articles or inflammatory broadcasts. It really can. Ah, mate, first baby, crikey, feels like yesterday. And yet also 100 years ago at the same time. 11:44, we'll talk again, Michael. I look forward to it. Emma's in Stevenage. Emma, what would you like to say?
Hello. I'm a paediatric nurse. I generally work in the community, but over the weekend I did a shift in A&E. I saw close to 60 patients in A&E on that Saturday that I worked, and a lot of them didn't require A&E treatment or care. It was GP required treatment and consultation. Fortunately, a lot of A&Es are doing this now, where they're employing GPs to come and work in the department, and we just transfer these patients over to them. So they're still in the hospital, they're still in the A&E department, they just see the GP instead of an A&E doctor or the paediatric doctors. And I agree with your first person that actually we just can't keep going like this,
no.
Both in the GP world and also in A&E. And I don't quite know what to do or what the issue and what the solution is, or, you know, and the cause of this.
So GPs are operating above capacity.
Yeah, and
A&Es
are
taking up some of the overflow from GPs that are above capacity, and the government and the Daily Mail are attacking the GPs for not seeing more people face to face, which would leave even more people left having to go to A&E because they wouldn't be able to get a telephone or an internet consultation.
Well, it's just like I was talking to one particular mother, because we're still operating on a one-parent basis with the children. And she just honestly said to me, well, I called 111 before coming here, and it's over 24 hours since they got back to me and they've said that I've got to come to A&E.
Right.
So even the triage, emergency triage system that we've got in place, that probably costs quite a lot of money to support GPs in out-of-hours and A&E, isn't quite working. Whatever we're doing, it isn't working. And I don't quite know what to do. All I know
is... I can tell from your voice.
My colleagues in GP land, us in A&E, in the community, and... additional services like 111 are all overworked. We're just seeing a lot of patients. Part of my
and you've been told
theory,
you're not seeing. You've been told you're not seeing enough. That's the message. That's
I haven't been told I'm not seeing enough.
GPs
I just think we're seeing so much. We just don't stop. It's endless. It's it's really busy. It's packed.
I mean, it's a simple response, but I think an accurate one, that there are too few people in the service. We need more professional. I mean, it is that simple. You can cut and dice it however you please, but there are epic shortages now being enormously exacerbated by, well, the most obvious is the bottlenecks and the backlogs that have grown up during the coronavirus, inevitably in most cases, and of course the fact that the NHS for many people born in continental Europe has become a much less attractive place to work. So we need more human beings doing the jobs that you and your colleagues do. And there is no other answer to this.
I also think Brexit has something to do with this. I'm sorry to say.
We're not really allowed to do that on this programme, Emma. We tend not to blame Brexit for anything on this programme.
But just saying that quite a lot of my colleagues that I used to work with over who are from overseas have had to leave to go back home because of the visas and everything else.
Just made but it harder. And also to feel less welcome. I was joking a bit. I don't know how often you listen to the show. I blame Brexit for...
It's a bit hit and miss when you're driving the car and stuff.
I was going to say, you've clearly got quite a lot to do. What with being a paediatric nurse and having a relatively young baby to look after, by the sounds of it.
Yes. I think all I was just also going to say is that I think we've lost the art of... and I'm going to use the word nursing here. Nursing ill people. Do you know, just for instance, when my grandmother was with her children, with my father and my aunts, she used to do what we call a fluid challenge. So you used to get some sugary water, make it up, cool it down, and feed it on a spoon. And I'm doing those basic things with diarrhea and vomiting, you know, talking about stripping off for temperatures, all these basic things that I think we've lost.
Well, that's relevant too. No, that's relevant too, and that's something actually the media could. Well, I don't know whether the media could help with that, but I mean that's a different issue entirely. Although at times like this, you're looking around for anything that might alleviate the enormous pressure put on the professionals that are still in the business. Emma and Stevenage there, just describing the reality of what she faces. That rather excitable rant I embarked upon earlier, and I don't use the word rant very often in the context of my own broadcasting, but I'm afraid today it fits. Chris Whitty has put in 11 words in his calm, cool, characteristic fashion. He's really expressed exactly what I was expressing when I was shouting at you about whether or not you'd take your kid to Quick Fit if they had long COVID. He just says, never worry about criticism from somebody you wouldn't take advice from. Funny that. And was it Whitty that got harassed in the street after one of the anti-vaccine protests? It was, wasn't it? Because I was about to say, well, I'm not sure he'd be that level-headed if he was getting abused in the street, but of course he has been. So it's very sage advice, that. Never worry about criticism from somebody you wouldn't take advice from. You're welcome to ignore him, you know. I'll have a word, shall I, with some of my old colleagues on Fleet Street. Ask them when they're free if you want to take your children around and show them the rashes and stuff, and find out what they think about it, because the doctors are the enemy. Where we're mounting a spirited defence of GPs, or at least a fairly straightforward suggestion that if a sector is underfunded, understaffed and unloved, then it's the fault of politicians Jeremy Hunt's got some front, hasn't he? And that's probably the safest rhyme that I can employ in these circumstances. Jeremy Hunt has got some front, honestly. He's attacked plans to increase face-to-face appointments for GPs, saying they will put pressure on a burnt-out workforce. Wasn't he the fellow that was going to deliver 5,000 new GPs? Although, given what a new hospital counts as under this particular government, a new GP would just be one who's changed his shirt, I think. And yet it's working. And I'm afraid I've reached a point, I wish my ego was big enough to believe we could make much of a difference. And I know I sometimes make a bit of a difference to you because you're daft enough to listen to this programme, but we don't really touch the sides on the national issues. David Davis today is trending on Twitter because he's saying, oh, I did warn about a lot of these Brexit problems. David Davis! Oh, yes, I warned about this. So if you are still, so I think the last caller brought Brexit into the conversation. If you're still clinging to the carcass of it, if today you go, oh, yes, that Lord Frosted, what a blinder he's played by making us the only country in the world that has internal trade borders, having promised, Boris Johnson promised that there wouldn't be any. So now, so desperate they are, sound like Yoda, so desperate are they to paint anything as a victory that they're now painting a potential reduction in checks and paperwork on goods coming from Great Britain into Northern Ireland as a win, when Brexit was built on the idea that there would be a reduction in all checks and paperwork everywhere, and now we're going to be, I think, the only country in the world that has trade barriers internally. But I told you this was going to happen, and I'm sick to death of being proved right. I told you that we would very soon, before the end of this year, they would be celebrating things are slightly less bad than they were before, or things are slightly less bad than they could be, as an actual win. The people that told you things were going to get better are now saying, well, things are only 20% worse than they were before, and it could have been 50%. It's like night follows day. But anyway, 11:57 is the time. Sam's in Hounslow. Sam, what made you pick up the phone?
Hi, James.
Hello.
Great show. Thank you for having me on.
You're very welcome.
So, my wife and I have been GPs for about 15 years now, and, you know, loved working in the NHS. The last couple of years have been, you know, pretty manic, as you can imagine.
Of course.
But, you know, the last 6 months, my wife and I have sat down and, the rhetoric that's coming from the government, and, you know, that's part of it, and you can live with it to a certain degree, but the real issue is that it's turning a lot of individuals, certainly the public against us, but, you know, it's actually causing division within the NHS, so, you know, within hospital consultants. There's certainly some resentment there that they feel that the doctors aren't, GPs aren't doing anything in terms of, you know, just sitting at home, just telephone triaging, not seeing anyone. So there's a lot of division there. And the main reason that I rang up is, you know, my wife and I have finally decided now that, you know, we've sort of teetered on the brink, but we've decided to emigrate now to Canada because, you know, we've been sort of seduced in terms of, you know, we've had a couple of calls with recruiters out there. We've spoken to a couple of doctors.
Seriously.
And what they have out there, you know, it's not necessarily the money. You know, it's funny because they pay a lot more for their doctors there anyway. But it's not the money. It's the respect. You know, when I was speaking, you know, there's a lot more respect. It's more practitioner-led. You know, there's less interference from the government. But the system that they have there seems a lot more efficient.
What was the straw that broke the camel's back, Sam? If there was one. I mean, it's a calm accumulation, isn't it? But was there a point at which you looked at each other and thought, that's it, we're off?
So to be honest, I can live with the government sprouting what BS that they do, right? Let's be honest.
Yeah.
It's just the interactions I've been having with patients. There's been a tide that's been turned. It's, you know, you get some lovely patients,
of course,
but some patients now are literally just taking the government for their word and just putting the onus on us in terms of, you know, we don't want to see anyone, you know, we're overpriced.
That's not the government, that's the Daily Mail. That's the Daily Mail that's done
that. Yeah, but, you know, they're also referenced, you know what the government
have got on board with it, that the government have got on board with it, but it began with those front pages and that depiction in the media, not just the Daily Mail. I'm sure it's happened here, portraying you as being sort of part-timers or sort of taking the mickey or swinging the lead. And that then impacts upon how patients talk to you, and that has prompted you to leave not just the NHS, but the whole bloody country.
And, you know, the health secretaries don't even talk to each other. You know, we had Hancock who was saying, yep, we should be doing more telephone consultations. And, you know, myself, I don't mind doing either, right? You know, sure. Great to see patients, but you see the value of telephone consultations. You know, I take my telephone consultations in the practice. I'm not at home. I'm still in the practice itself. And if I need to call in patients, you know, I can call them in quite easily, on even on the same day, if need be, right? It's just the rhetoric of, you know, the Javid is now saying, well, you know, we should be seeing more face-to-face. Well, hang on, your colleague only recently was saying you should be moving more to telephone so you can see more patients. Make up your mind, right, guys?
Don't laugh. Is there anything we can do to make you stay?
I just, no, trust me, I would love to stay. For me, it's just, I think people just need to be a little bit kinder. You know, you say on your show all the time, right? People are going to, you know, are going to wonder why there's a lack of doctors. You know, and I say this generally, you know, I know there's a lack of GPs, but there's a lack of doctors, there's a lack of staff just generally. It's not funny why we've got that situation. It's not maybe because we haven't got the money to pay them. It's the fact that people just don't want to work in this environment. That's the sad truth, I think. It's you know, we've got, in my practice alone, we've got vacancy. We just can't fill them. We can't get enough doctors to come in. We can't get locum doctors. We can't get the salary doctors to come in. It's because just people just don't want to. And even if you do, you know, they just want to work a couple of days.
Sure.
It's the intensity of, you know, I don't work in a lot of fields, but it's difficult for me to try to convey my role when I speak to other people who work, you know, I don't know, in office jobs and stuff. It's just the sheer intensity, you know, having to see patients over and all. Telephone consultations, yeah, we get 5 minutes to do a telephone consultation, right?
Yeah.
But no, nothing takes 5 minutes. You know, by the time you say, hello, how are you doing, whatever, you're in 3 minutes.
Sure.
So you automatically have a backlog of patients that are called through that. And it's just, you know, so much admin. You know, when I was speaking to the folks over in Canada, they were saying we just hardly have any admin. It's the amount of admin is minimal. And it's shocking how much admin we have to do here on top of seeing the patients and so forth. So, I don't know. I said to my wife, it'd be nice to go over there and, you know, maybe go for a year and so forth and see then see whether we want to come back or not.
Wow. I wish I could say something to dissuade you from doing that, or I wish I could point something out that you might have missed, but even I'm not that cocky. I can just wish you luck, and I hope you come back.